The following presentation was recorded at the 2016 SouthEast LinuxFest in Charlotte, North Carolina. It is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For more information about the SouthEast LinuxFest, please visit www.southeastlinuxfest.org. The SouthEast LinuxFest would like to thank the following diamond sponsors in 2016 for helping make these videos possible.
Hello everyone, welcome to MySQL Replication for Grown-Ups. This is our safe harbor statement. I'll give you a moment to read it, but basically it says that what you're about to hear may or may not be something that you can may or may not be able to hold account, because I may or may not be talking about things that may or may not be related. However, I can tell you in this particular presentation, everything you see is available in the latest releases of MySQL. My name is Chuck Bell. I have a number of years' experience with MySQL. I am one of the members of the Oracle MySQL team, and I've written a book or two about MySQL and a few other things. How many people here are planning or just getting started using replication? Two. Okay, good. See me after. So I'm going to talk today about what is MySQL replication. I'm going to give you a very short introduction to MySQL replication so you can get an idea of what we're talking about today. I'll talk a little bit about the binary log, specifically to give you an idea of why global transaction identifiers are so much better than the old way. And then I'll talk a little bit about global transaction identifiers and give you, toward the end, some best practices, some ideas for moving forward, and those kinds of things. So let's start with, what is MySQL replication? Well, succinctly, MySQL replication is simply a redundancy mechanism that replicates and it changes from one server to one or more servers. Therefore, you can make copies of your database, and this mechanism is designed to do that, and it does it real time. The originating server, we use a term called master. You may see that a lot in the documentation. And servers that receive the changes are called slaves. There are many use cases for replication, not the least of which is hot backup. So if your master is running, something happens, if you have replication set up to a slave, you can take the slave and make it the master and get things going back again. That's called hot backup. Recovery, of course, is if something really bad happens, that you can get the data back from the slaves and go forward. Similar type thing, but in this case, we're talking about recovery from major catastrophes, that kind of thing. High availability is another big use case for MySQL replication, so making your data available as long as you can, 5 nines even potentially. And then, of course, there's also performance. You can use MySQL replication for performance, and I'll show you a slide on that. So if you have a lot of readers and only a few writers, for example, that's a classic case of MySQL replication being used to read scale out for performance. And there are two mechanisms now that we have for MySQL replication. The old way, which most of you who have ever used replication probably know a lot about, and that's the binary log file and position. And that method uses a log file, which we'll see, and a position within the log file in order to figure out where the master is with its current events, and more specifically, where the slave needs to start reading the master's next. We also call that particular type of mechanism anonymous replication. It's called anonymous because the slaves, when they read the events, don't really know where that particular event or change came from. As you'll see, global transaction identifiers, we can determine where it came from. So the new mechanism is global transaction identifiers. Here's a slide that illustrates the scale-out. So if you have several write clients, and you can set up a master and slave, a simple topology here, and have lots of read clients. And then, if you need more read clients, so your applications, most applications, that is, are heavy readers, so you do a lot of select designated inserts kind of thing. So you simply add more slaves, connect more clients to those slaves, and that's called read scale out. You can also set it up, of course, for redundancy. So if you have a topology here, on the left is a master and two slaves. If the master crashes, then all you have now are two disconnected slaves. But you can do what we call promotion, and you promote one of the slaves to the new master, connect the existing slaves to the master, and off you go, you're back up again. So another use case is reducing overhead for work. So a classic example is backup. You can use a slave to get copies of your data and then take the backup on the slave. If you have a lot of data or you're doing some intensive backups, whatever, then you all know that the performance drain on the database sort of could be potentially large, especially if you need to do a backup during peak time. But you can overcome some of those limitations by using replication and backup slave. You can also use it for long distance distributions. If you have sites in multiple locations, you can replicate the data amongst them geographically. Now this particular drawing shows what we call a circular replication topology, where each machine is a master and a slave to one other machine. So we use a circle. And there's some interesting things you have to do to manage circular replication. And if you're interested in something like that, I encourage you to look at the online documentation, because it has a lot of descriptions about circular replication and a number of other types of topologies. So let's talk about the binary log. That's where all of this comes in. The binary log, of course, is used in both anonymous replication and global transactional logs. So when a slave connects to the master, now this applies to both forms, when the slave connects to the master, it sends a request to the master to start replication. In anonymous replication, at that point, the slave provides the binary log file name and position that it wants to start reading from. And then the master starts sending all that information. So the slave starts getting the information back. So that's a two-step process. Let's see it in practice. So here we have a master and a slave. We have a client connected to the master, and the client is going to create a new table. So the master takes the query, processes, creates the table, and then writes in the binary log, you see there's a create commit. Now, depending on what form that you use with the binary log, you can have three methods: statement based, in which case it's going to write the actual SQL statement in the binary log; row based, which only records the changes to the data; or something we call mixed, which is has some interesting connotations depending on how you use it. And in anonymous replication, it doesn't really matter which one you choose if there are some consequences. For example, with statement based, if you do random number generations, there's some extra work that has to go on, and there are a number of restrictions that way. But if you do row based replication, again, all you're sending is the changes, so therefore you don't have to worry about setting up the right date times, or seeding the random generator, and so on. So on the next slide, you'll see that the slave will get the event, process it, and create the table on its side. Now, I'll split these in multiple slides to show you that it's not an instantaneous thing. Although, in a low bandwidth situation, not much data being replicated, it practically happens, you know, instantaneously. But with high bandwidth, lots of data, and that kind of thing, there could be a delay. And there's all kinds of strategies about managing the delay in replication. Again, it's kind of an advanced time. So let's see, things keep going here. We have an insert on the master, which again, the data is written, and then it's written to the binary log, and then it gets transmitted to the slave, and it implements that. So that's how the binary log works. Whether it's anonymous replication or global transaction identifiers, it works the same way, the mechanism that is. So what does the binary log look like? Binary log is a file-based log. It really is a file on the file system, and I'll show you some examples. It simply records the changes on the master. Again, it can be statement or row-based or mixed. The events, now that's the changes that we call. Each event is like a select, an insert, update, something like that. That's what we call an event. So they're grouped by, of course, transactions, assuming you're in transaction processing. And they look in a stream kind of thing in the binary log. We see it begin, we see one or more events, and then it commits. And that's how it shows up in the binary log. You can look at the binary log, whether it's statement-based or row-based. It's easier to read with the statement-based, but if SQL statement's right there for you. And row-based is a little harder to read, because it's not human readable. But there is a utility, a C client, so they call MySQL finlog, which comes with a server that you can use to inspect binary logs. So the log files are not one continuous file. They could be if you want to be, but logically, it's going to be nonsense because eventually they're going to grow very, very large. So you use multiple files. And there's a mechanism built in, and I'll show you the command in a moment, to close out one file and open another. That event is called a rotate event. So when you rotate the logs, you close the old one and open the new one. So therefore, the files start with a format description at the top, all the events, and then at the end, the rotate event. That way, when the state reads these files that are transmitted to it, it knows how to follow it. It knows which binary log to process next and so on. And here's what the rotate event looks like. So if you wanted to actually rotate the logs, you would issue flush logs. And that will close the existing log and the new one. So on your master, the file logs, binary logs will look like this. And you can change the name. In this particular example, just start with master-bin, and then the file extension, that's what we're used to calling it. It's simply a sequence number. In this case, starting with one, the first one, two, so on. But there's another file called MySQL-bin, with the same name as the binary log file. .index, which keeps track of the files in the proper order. So that way, if you rename the binary log and restart the server, the slaves and whatnot can figure out which one to read next. So if you want to look at them, you can. You can simply use a cat command and cat. Now the slave, things are a little different. The slave, when it reads the binary logs transmitted from the master, it saves them in a file of the same format, but it's called the slave relay log. So we think of it as kind of a cache. So the slave has two threads. One thread is pulling stuff from the master, putting it in the relay log. Another thread is taking things out of the relay log and executing it. So the slave's relay logs have a similar format. They're usually named differently, but they have a similar index file and SQL file. One additional piece of information that you might see is the master.info file. Now that's the older way that we used to do it. That's a file-based way of recording all the information about how to connect to the master. Now in the MySQL 5.7, we have that information can be stored in the table. It's part of our crash state slave feature. And that's how I would recommend. You always log that information to the table rather than the file. But you can still use it in the file. Now, there are a lot of challenges with using the binary log. The last 10 minutes made it sound pretty easy to use, and it is until things go wrong. So you can use the binary log to recover from crashes. Called point-in-time recovery. And the idea is, you do your backups as normal, but when you do your backup, you record the position and file name of the current binary log. That way, if something happens between your last backup and your next backup, you know which log to start at, which point to start at, and start reading the events from the existing binary logs. That's called point-in-time recovery report. But does you absolutely no good if you don't remember what the binary log file and position is. And so if you use a backup scheme that doesn't record that information, it could get a little ugly. Errors in replication are also another thing that can be challenging. So if you have an event, let's say you have a diversion occur on one of your slaves, where for whatever reason, one of the tables was altered. Right? So never mind the fact that you fire the guy that did that, but if one of your tables altered, the event that occurred on the master may not work on the slave. Now there's usually not, that's an obvious one, but there's usually a little more subtle than that. And then there's things like character set changes, time zone changes, those kinds of things. Little differences on between the servers that could cause problems with processing events. And in that case, the slave will typically stop, and you're going to have to figure out what is wrong and try to overcome that particular event. But there's no real easy way to do that without manual intervention. Another thing is, as I already mentioned, there's no way to figure out where the event came from. All you know is that it came from a master. And if you're connected to the master, you can assume it came from the master. But not necessarily. In circular replication topology, events get propagated. And at some point, you have to figure out, oh, I've already seen that event. And there are ways to do that. But it's not automatic. But again, the bottom line is, if something goes wrong, it's a manual intervention to fix it. Good news is, there are some great toolkits out there to help you overcome a lot of these problems. And in fact, there are toolkits out there to help you tune, if you will, or at least recognize when you need to tune MySQL replication. Most notably, the Percona toolkit has a number of tools for working with replication, and our own MySQL utilities have a number of things to work with. There's a better way. Global transaction identifiers. So let's talk about any questions up to this point. Okay, when we design global transaction identifiers, we identify three major goals. There are many others, but these three major goals are what you, our customers, want to see. That is, simplify your general administration of replication, improve replication data flow, and most importantly, enable automatic failover. If you think about anonymous replication, where you have to know the file name or position, if the master goes away, how do you know who the slave, what position the slave is at, so you can start who the slave is at? You know, there are ways to do that, and there are tricks to reconcile that, but there's no way to automate. The global transaction identifiers that you'll see, we've solved that problem. Global transaction identifiers can also be grouped together, unlike in the anonymous replication, where they are distinctly separate. And you really didn't really have any way of knowing which events you need to execute first. So global transaction identifiers also helped us implement what I call a multi-thread slave. So now the slave can process more than one event at a time in its relay log. Before, with anonymous replication, it can only do one at a time. That was a single thread. We now have multiple threads. So the servers are designed to skip global transaction identifiers that have already been executed. That's big. That's huge. Because before, if you were to stop your slave or something and reconnect it to the master, and you get that binary file name and position wrong, you got it earlier than what it was, the slave will happily try to re-execute those events. So recreating a table that already exists, guess what? Slave stops, that's bad. With global transition identifiers, we can allow the communication protocol between master and slave to determine what exists in the procedure. So no more binary log file collisions. Of course, there are lots of benefits. It's, again, easier replication setup. Automatic log position, you got to remember where it is. Everything's already set for you. Reduced overhead, as you'll see. And it's a lot easier to troubleshoot once you learn how they work. More importantly, it enables all kinds of advanced replication features. And it is our what we're building a lot of our future stuff on. So global transaction identifier is pretty much going to be what you're going to want now on. So what do they look like? Well, every global transaction identifier is built from two parts. One is a server UUID, which uniquely identifies that server. So now we know where the events come from. We have that built into the GTID. And the second part is the sequence number. And it's simply an increasing number of the events. So from server X, sequence numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, it's simply the order in which those global transaction identifiers were created. That is written to the binary log ahead of the transaction. So you see in the drawing below, you see GTID, then the begin, the event, and the commit. And that's how it's written. And there's an example on the GTID from the book. The only funny thing is that if you need to do any really low level diagnostic or repair or something like that, GTIDs can be an eyesore when you look at them. Okay, I can't remember all that. It's a huge number, but luckily, it doesn't pay for part of it from the NFT. So let's talk about the protocol. So remember, I talked about when the slave connects to the master, it does some negotiation with the master, and then tells the master, I want to start from this file on this position. Well, in global transaction identifiers, it's a little different. In this case, the slave connects to the master and says, hey, this is my list of global transaction identifiers that I've already executed. Give me what I don't have. So the master only sends what the slave doesn't have. So in this drawing, you'll see the slave has global transaction ID 1, ID 2, but the master has ID 1, ID 2, and ID 3. So therefore, slave will only get ID3 after it connects. That's pretty neat. So let's look at this in a little bit different way. Again, the classic topology of master and slave, when the slave connects, it sends in its list to the master, and then master returns only with the list of things it's missing. So think about that for a minute. In failover, we've got a master that goes down. We have all of our slaves. Which slave do you pick? Replication, anonymous replication experts will tell you, well, you have to pick the slave that's most up to date. Well, how do you know? Well, you've got to figure out the binary logs, files, and positions. Okay? So you got to go to each slave and say, where are you, and so on and so forth, and it's a little tedious. The global transaction identifier, short of a slave being really behind, like having thousands of entries in its relay log that it has to process, aside from that, you can pick any slave as the master. Because each slave from there on will send its list to that new master and say, give me what I don't have. So it doesn't really matter. Furthermore, you know, you can identify what's missing in the topology. So here's another one. This is about automatic position. Here we have a master and two slaves. So this master has this transaction 3. So something happens between the time the transaction 3 is created and before it gets submitted to the slave. So something bad happens, ID3 is lost. So there goes the master. Now we have two slaves. Which one do we pick? Well, again, you can pick either one, it doesn't matter. But let's say we pick B as the master. So slave C connects to the new master P and sends what it has, and of course it gets back the missing transaction. That's how it works. Really. So a little more about failover, another example. And in this case I'm going to compare failover with anonymous transactions in global transaction enterprise. So
picture to the last slide. If you had picked C, and C has transaction 1, but B has transaction 1 and 2, wouldn't there be a discrepancy though?
Like, I'm going to get it. I'm going to pick it up.
Repeat the question, please.
Okay, yeah.
Well, so like with B would still send 2 to C?
Yeah, B would still send its transaction.
Even though it's not the master?
Yeah. So, and here's the technique. Now let me explain that a little bit more. When you recover automatic failover. In this case, the question was, if we chose C, but has fewer transactions than B, which had more transactions, how do you reconcile that? And the process you reconcile that is, you take the slave that you want to be the new master, and you make it a slave of every other slave that's out there. So there's a process to do that. If you use the MySQL failover utility, that process is automated for you. Does it all for you. So it will automatically fail over and recover. So that's why I meant by, yes, you can recover all the transactions. But that's the technique that you use to do it.
Yes.
So again, with global transaction identifiers and failover, it's simple to track and compare replication across the cluster over your topology. You can identify the most up-to-date slave, although it doesn't really matter. Again, if you use that process, you're going to recover everything anyway. And that process, by the way, that I just explained, is very important. Because if you have a very dispersed topology, and you have slaves that are, some are fast, some are slow, some may be overburdened with certain things, and they don't have everything. But logically, we usually pick the slave that has the best hardware. What's the fastest one? Because we're assuming the master is gone and never coming back. And in that case, it may not be the optimal master to choose. But if you follow that process, you automatically recover. You couldn't do that with anonymous transactions. You have all kinds of problems with binary log files, which is just crazy. So let's look at this. So failover before global transaction identifier. Say we have a master and two slaves, one of which is supposed to be called relay slave, because it's a master, it's a slave for the first master, but it's also a master for another machine. And each one has a certain binary log. This assumes the binary log is turned on the slave. When the master goes away, now we must figure out the file number and position that we need to use for the new master, assuming we're going to take the one on the top, and how to set the rest of them to point to it. We've got to reconcile those files and positions. with global transaction identifiers. With global transaction identifiers, on the other hand, we have global transaction identifiers on all the servers. Each server has its own global transaction identifier, and we move on from there. So same topology, we have different IDs amongst the servers. Now, when the master goes away, again, within that process, we can reconnect everything, choose a new master, everything's back together. We gather up all the global transaction identifiers, so different through the protocol itself, and off we run. So, comparing global transaction identifiers and binary log file position, there's a lot of differences here. There's things that are really exciting when you bring the old master back online. So, we've got a situation where the master's gone away, you've prepared it, and now you want to return it to serve as the master. How do you do that? Well, with the old way of doing it, you bring it back online, but now you have the potential that the missing transactions get reinjected into the stream. You've got to, again, reconcile the binary log files at position, possibly even overcome errors on the slave once it starts running. With global transaction identifier, you simply make it a slave of the new master. So they take the old master that was down, bring it back as a slave of the new master, and then switch the roles. All you have to do. Pretty neat. So with global transaction identifiers, we've all grown up. Everything is fitting a lot better for us. And most of the problems are solved for us. There are some restrictions with global transaction identifiers. And this is where, if you've been using replication for some time, maybe some older versions, those kind of things, especially if you still use MyITM, you'll find that that's a pretty big one for us. Global transaction identifiers, you know, from the name alone, it's designed for transaction processing. So if you use MyITM, it's in the same transaction. You got an NODB table and you're doing something in the middle of it. To begin, do something with an ISIM table, do something with an NODB, and then commit, that's going to work for you. Similarly, create table select, or create table select, it's not permitted in a statement based replication. Problem is, it works with role based replication, the old anonymous form, but it gets two events. And those events can get different GTIDs. So by nature, particularly if you have auto-commit turned on, that we don't allow that. Temporary tables is another thing we don't allow for the transaction identifier. And finally, of course, anything that's going to break transaction processing, we don't allow that. And the way we handle that is we request that you turn on enforced GTID consistency. And in that case, if something comes along that doesn't violate or is going to be a problem with GTIDs, it'll throw an error instead of crashing into slave, for example. Let's see how we enable global transaction identifiers. Now, what I'm going to show you is basically five set of methods for doing it. If you're still using 5.6, from 5.6.5 to up to 5.7.6, I think it is. There were some extra steps in setting up global transaction identifiers. Most notably, you had to turn on binary logging on the slave. Now, you don't have to do that anymore with the 1.5.6.7 and beyond. So the steps are this. You stop replication on your receiver, your slave, and you stop replication. So you can stop the receiver and apply our threads on the slave, or you simply stop the slave. And then you adjust your configurations, and you'll see there's some extra things that need to change. And then you configure the slave to replicate from the master using automatic positions instead of the binary on file position. And then start your slave. So let's see those steps one at a time. So if your replication is already running, there's a couple extra things you need to do. So step one might be optional, but essentially the best way to do it is allow your slave to synchronize. And the way to do that is you can turn off access on your master, put it in read-only mode, and then check the slave status until it read all of its related logs. So all the slaves have caught up on that. Then you can stop both servers, so it needs to take them. You can restart both servers with the global transaction identifiers enabled, setting the correct options, and I'll show you that in a minute. And then you tell the slave select to connect to the master using the new option automatic position. And then you can follow along with the examples on these lines, of course, in the documentation. And finally, you can re-enable read mode on the master and then reply to server. So here are the steps, one at a time. Again, synchronizing the server is the best way to do this, is to turn read only on. In a perfect world, your master only takes writes, never your slave. Okay. That makes sense, right? Because the slaves aren't going to replicate back to the master. But you'd be surprised how many people we run into have allowed writing to the slaves. So you should only turn on, you'll should only have to turn on read only on the master, but it's safe to turn on all the servers, just in case. Then, of course, allow the slave to catch up the master. You can do that by monitoring the show slave status. Then you stop both servers, and then there's a command you can do it, a number of ways to do it, that's a nice way to do it. And then, to enable GTID replication, you simply pass in either at the start command startup, or you put it in a tree file. We prefer to put in a tree file, so you do it that way, as you may think. Set GT mode, that's the parameter you need, set it to on. Also, include the enforcer GTID consistency, and you should be fine. You can do some, if you have some issues, you can just give the late start option if you need to do any kind of things related to that. So here's an example. MySQL GTID mode is on, and simply enforce GTID consistent. Obviously, the master has to have binary logging, so you're restarting it from existing topology you already turned on. Now, connecting the slave to the master is a familiar looking command. Change master 2, you see at the bottom, of course, you have the host, port, user, password. And there's a better way to do that with password, but that's the old way. But the important thing to draw your attention to is the last option, master auto position equals 1. And that's what turns on the global transaction identifier protocol. And from there on, now you're running the global transaction identifier. And you can start the slave. Then, of course, go after your master and turn off the read only. I know that reasonable time, turn off the read only. Okay, so you may be wondering, that's great, but what if I already have replication running and I can't stop my server? Can you do it online? And the answer is, yeah, sure you can. A couple extra steps, and I'll show you how to do that. So here we have a situation where we have replication running, and we can't take all the servers down. Maybe some of your slaves can take down, but you really can't take them all down. For whatever reason, we can't. Here's how you can do it online. So you first start off by enabling GTIP consistency on all your servers. Master sent things. The next step is turn global transaction identifiers on all your servers. Now, you have to use a special option here. It's called off permissive. Off permissive says, I'm going to use global transaction identifiers, but not yet. In other words, prepare me to use global transaction identifier, but keep my existing anonymous, or if I'm switching from anonymous to GTIP back to anonymous, that kind of thing, global transaction identifier. So it will continue to read your existing events. That's the important part there. So that's the master and slave. Now, once you you can, once everything is set to off permission, then you can set everything to on permission. That's the opposite. That says, okay, from here on, use global transaction identifier, but allow anonymous transactions if they're still out there. Off permissive. Now you have to wait. But we have some really cool things that you can do. There's a show status like option that you can use called ongoing anonymous transaction count. So you've gone from anonymous to GTIDs, and now you're watching the count to make sure it goes to zero. Once it goes to zero on all your slaves, now you're cooking with GTIDs. Then you can go in and turn GTID on. And that's how you can do it online. Of course, the next step is you're going to want to turn that on in your config file. So you go back to your config file, put GTID mode in each one of your servers on, enforce GTID consistency on in all of your config files. Okay, well, that's it, they're back up. Now, another step that you might want to do is you might want to test everything. And you could do that, for example, stop one of the slaves. You can configure the slave to replicate using our acquisition. So you could do it with one slave. And this is basically the same steps I just showed you, but done a little bit more carefully. In this case, here are the actual commands to this. So simply change master to the master all position. Notice I didn't put host and all that stuff in there. Well, in this example, that information is in the table. And so it's not reading from the file, or it reads the file every time. Simply change the option. And then show slave status, and it will tell you what it's doing. And then at the end, if you want to monitor it, you can create some data on the master, check the master, you see that on the bottom there, show master status. Now you start seeing things like GTID sets down the bottom. So I will show you the set. And I will call your attention to that. You may not be able to see it in the back, but that's got this really long UID. At the end, it says 1-5. There are 5 GTIDs in that set. Okay, so it's not just 1 GTID, it's 5. And that's what I mentioned earlier about a GTID set. You can check the status on the slave. We have a command we use select against the performance schema, threads, to find out the slave threads are running, the first part. Second part, we can do a select against the performance schema again, those connection status. And notice in the connection status, we also see receive transaction status. And now we start to see GTIDs show up everywhere. And then the last one again for performance schema to show the status of a particular service state of the application. You can look at the binary log. You can still use that same command, show in log events, and it will show you. In this case, I'm doing from a particular position, and it will show you all the particular events. So there we have all kinds of additional GTIP commands in there mixed in. Greetings. Do all that. Any questions so far? I know this is kind of a bit of a fire hose, so I want to make sure I have plenty of time for questions at the end. Okay. Let's talk about best practices. Again, you can use statement, row, or mixed with GTIDs, but we recommend row-based replication. There is a table you may want to check out, and there's discussed in the documentation as well. And the GTID executable. And it's going to say all of the GTIDs that have been executed. So you can query for the GTIDs if you want to. In fact, you can do some interesting things and calculate the missing GTID set between a master and a slave. Simply we're using this table and a few other things that we have. Now, if there an event occurs on the slave that the slave cannot process, and it's entirely possible through no fault of your own, i.e., your users, that the slave may not have something it needs to execute a transaction. If that happens, you can recover from it by simply inserting a blank transaction with the same GTIP ID. If you recall on anonymous replication, if you needed to skip something on the slave, there was an actual variable you had to set to tell it how many events to skip. You couldn't tell it which particular events to skip. You had to wait till the slave read it and it crashed, and then you can tell, okay, skip the next one or the next two. You know, it doesn't matter where it is in this case. You simply tell the slave, hey, I'm telling you, forget what you thought you had. You have already read this, and you simply insert a blank transaction. So you have to know the GTIP to put in there. But from that point on, it skips on that slave forever. There's an easier way to do that. You can use a utility called MySQL Slave for transaction. And that skips a transaction in the slave. So you could have case where you need to skip multiple transactions. And so this utility can help reconcile that for you. It will actually present a list of the GTIDs that can be skipped, potentially skipped on the slave. It's up to you to determine whether it's right or not. So you can do a dry run and say, what would happen if I did this? And it'll check it and figure it out. And there's a great blog on this, by the way. The proponent guys did an excellent work on this blog. And I highly recommend you do that. Look at that. The slave transaction goes into great detail about how it actually works. So some of the use cases for this are recovering from erroneous situations. Again, something happened with your users, or what we wrote it for originally was parent transactions, and I'll talk about those in a minute. Parent transactions. The requirements and assumptions of using MySQL slave transactions, of course, is that everybody's using GTIDs. It's not going to work for anonymous replication. And of course, the user that you use to connect to the masters have to have super privilege, because we're actually going to be reading things related to GTIDs that only super users can read. Now, parent transactions, this is an interesting thing. It is entirely possible that a transaction can be inserted into your replication stream accidentally. And sometimes legitimately, but it can cause problems. So, for example, classic example, you set up replication. You got your master, you got your slave, you set everything up, and a wonderful thing is going on, then you create a user on the master. So then you'll find out you put a slave and you create another user on the slave. It's still appear. Now the master goes down and you use that slave as a new master, and he replicates that user to another slave, and you lose them. So you could be a time bomb ticking. You know, you're changing data through your topology, you know, for a normal maintenance kind of thing, you're not thinking, you know, this is going to quite be later, but it could happen that way. And that's what we call an errant transaction. You can overcome that pretty easy, and again, the utility is designed to help you do that. You figure out which the GTIDs are that you need to skip, and you issue a blank transaction for those. So you can set the GTID next to that list, and it could be a list, you could do one more. And then at the end, you set it back to automatic. So, there are lots of utilities, again, with MySQL utilities, Persona, and some of the MySQL utilities we have are MySQL failover, which allows you to do automatic failover. That's an interesting one. We wrote that to connect to a master, look at the master, and check the master periodically. We call it an interval. And so at each interval, it asks the master, are you still alive? And the way it does that, by default, is it connects to the master. Tries to connect to the master, if it doesn't connect, then it says, can't connect. I'll try dinging it. So you could change how long it takes. And if it can't connect, it can't ding, it'll try connecting it one more time. And if it can't connect at that point, it declares the master captain, takes the slave, promotes it, connects it to all the other slaves, and makes it the master. So it automatically does all that routine I described for you. The limitation with that, of course, is that it's designed to monitor one and only one master. So if you need to monitor a whole farm of masters, then you would use our product MySQL pattern to do that. And I can talk more about that if you like. Fine. We have utilities for switchover. Now, the difference between switchover and failover is about, has to do with whether the server is alive or not. So in the case of the server goes down, that's failover. If you actually want to change the role from the master to slave and vice versa, then that's called switchover. So it all has to do with those the servers up and out. And of course, I already talked about slave and master. So with all these things that we have, with global transaction identifiers, we can achieve better high availability through MySQL global transaction identifiers. I mentioned there are online reference manual. Here's the actual chapter in 5.7 documentation on replication. And it starts talking about the binary log, much like I did, and then jumps right into global transaction identifiers. There are a number of additional presentations that you'll find out on our website that talk about global transaction identifiers. You can see those here as well. Okay, any questions? Good. All right. I had one. Yeah.
You just on the first part of MySQL failover is that when the master reconnects, it joins quality again. That's actually really good feature.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So the point was that MySQL failover has another feature, and that is you can take the master and have it rejoin the topology. That's pretty good. Yes, sir.
Do you have any suggestions for monitoring? Sorry. Do you have any suggestions for monitoring gaps in the GTID sets in case you have replication issues?
Yeah. So, as a matter of fact, since I'm wearing the Oracle shirt, I can tell you. You want to use our monitoring tools for that. So we do have tools, MySQL Monitor, that you can use as part of our Enterprise Edition, and it has all kinds of things to monitor your application, including total transaction. It's pretty well covered there. Other tools do it too, but those are our critical. You know, they gave us red shirts, you know. Red shirt, okay, that's a little risky. Yes, sir. All
trying to name Google, we actually went through thousands of names.
The name of the company has now become its own verb in the dictionary.
Let's Google it.
You can Google it.
Work the Google on the internet machine.
Six simple letters on a plain white page.
Being able to do searches in any language about any country.
Thing, when you're putting in a question, they'd finish your question for you.
We have been working on organizing the world's information.
Our goal is to digitize all the books.
Today, Google announced Gmail. Email for everyone for free.
Google is mapping the entire world to make it more accessible to people everywhere.
Google is jumping into the mobile market.
Android was built as an open platform for everyone to use and build on.
This is Chrome. It's a faster, safer browser for the open web.
Google is unveiling what they call the knowledge graph.
We needed to understand the world the way you and I do, as objects and relationships between objects.
Today, Google's got another useful feature with Google Now.
We are providing you with answers before you've even asked for
them. One of my favorite cards is the one that shows traffic data for your commute to and from work.
Think about how far Google has evolved from the 10 blue links.
We asked ourselves, how can we assist you right when you need it?
Okay, Google, call the Walker Art Center.
It's not just desktops, phones, and laptops anymore.
Okay, Google. 유진이한테 5분 늦는다고 문자 보내줘.
It's watches with displays, car consoles with displays.
Okay, Google, let's go to the aquarium.
How can we help you get things done in as few steps as possible?
Okay, Google.
Okay, Google.
Okay, Google. Show me my photos of Lucas with the pumpkin.
But we have to remember, we have a long way to go.
This is just the tip of the iceberg.
just the right.